Okay, so let me start with some odds and ends, which are simple. One of the problems of going to here, I'm going to just go to make it smaller, and then I can get through this more easily. Okay, odds and ends. Okay, so these are just tidbits. So, and again, language is changing, language is evolving, and you don't have to follow rules. You can just say whatever you want. On the other hand, in formal writing, especially, or giving physics talks, it's a good idea probably to follow the rules. Avoid hopefully, because it really means in a manner full of hope. It doesn't mean I hope, and this is a mistake that so common that in a few years, hopefully, will mean I hope. Anyway, the word there is an adverb, meaning in that place, so it cannot be the subject of a sentence. This mistake occurs a gazillion times, even in the New York Times, so watch out for it. There means in that place. And so many sentences start with things like, there is a large dog in that hallway. Okay, that's correct. But you would say, there are several large dogs in this room. You wouldn't say, there is several large dogs in this room. There can't be the subject. It's large dog or large dogs that's the subject. Okay, now who, whom? I got this from the web just this afternoon, Oxford English Dictionaries. So just some examples. Who made this decision? Who is the subject? Whom do you think we should support? Whom is the object of the verb support? To whom do you wish to speak? Whom is following the preposition to? The man whom you met yesterday is coming to dinner. And so whom is the object of the verb met. So you see, this is a relative pronoun, and it takes its case from the role it plays in the clause in which it occurs. Not the role that the clause plays in the sentence. The children, who had been as good as gold, then suddenly started misbehaving. The people to whom the funds were supposedly directed benefited little from them. Now, these as I said to you a couple of times ago, you can get away, in most cases, using who all the time and skipping whom. On the other hand, in formal writing, maybe you should follow these rules. On the other hand, there are cases where you've got to use whom. For example, the Millennium Stadium accompanies 72,000 spectators, all of whom are seated. You can't say all of whom. It just sounds dumb. Congratulations to all the winners, most of whom are definitely reading this blog. So those are some examples. Yeah.
In the second to last example, I feel
the second
it's
which?
Whom is commonly replaced by which? The children. The Millennium Stadium, the second lines. I feel like whom is often replaced by which.
Well, that's, I would say that wouldn't be a good idea to replace it by which. That may be a common error, but it's not such a good idea to do. But you're right, that's probably a mistake. So any comments on this? As I said, the last two are obligatory. The others are probably My advice is follow these rules, especially in formal talks and especially in formal writing. Talks, you get a lot of leeway, even in formal talks. You can really get away with who all... The thing to really avoid is using whom when you should say who. Because that is not only a mistake, but it's a pretentious mistake. So using the rules correctly can be thought to be overly formal in some contexts, but no one's going to criticize you as long as you use the words correctly. So be careful not to use whom incorrectly. I suppose that's the main lesson for this. All right, anything else? All right. And let's remember, once again, there is an adverb and hopefully means in a manner full of hope. All right, now some of you kindly did send me samples of writing, and I tried to make some corrections to some of these. So let me now go down to a small size so that I can get through this thing rapidly. I don't even know. Is this an easy way? Somebody must have a better way of scrolling through a preview file.
Does page up do anything?
Huh?
Does page up do anything?
Say it again.
Page up and page down. It's a button on the...
What's what I try? You mean these arrows down here?
I've never used preview before, so I don't really know how it works, but there should be a page up button.
All right, wait a minute. Now, all right, let's...
Well, with Mac, do you have to use
all right, let's go to this... Here's one example. Do you have a way?
Maybe I can try.
Huh?
Maybe try command, and there's a button that says PGE up on the upper right, or it might just be PG, where it might actually say page.
God, I don't know what you're talking about. Page up button somewhere. All right. Look. I'll just.
They don't have.
Okay. Command shift.
Usually they have it specified on one of the F's, but they're just all random symbols that make no sense.
Okay. So here was a raw text that someone sent to me, I will. Focus here on. English here. We can collectively improve this text this afternoon. I've just done a very quick pass at correcting the salient errors. Okay, or things that I could easily correct. So, well, incredible is a pretty heavy-duty word. Special relativity, I would have said special relativity offers amazing, perhaps, benefits to those interested in reaching a distant point in space. Even there, I would have, that sentence needs work, let me just say that. The star Betelgeuse is approximated to be 640 light years from Earth. Well, that needs work. I change it to is approximately 640 light years from Earth. And the minimum travel time for anything coming to or from, for anything coming from or going to Betelgeuse, that has to be changed that way, for anything coming from or going to Betelgeuse, and then it's from an observer. All right, so Earth should be capitalized. Let me show you how I changed this. I wrote here is approximately 640 light years, and the moon, well, I didn't fix coming to or anyway, anything, what one should have said was for anything going to Betelgeuse and leave out coming, in the rest frame of an observer on Earth is 640 years. And I think those two commas should have gone. As I said, this was, I corrected the main things. The text up here has a serious mistake here. Using is, what's the technical word, a participle? Is that right, a present participle?
A gerund.
Huh?
A gerund.
A gerund. All right, maybe it's a gerund. All right, anyway, whatever it is, it has to modify a subject. John using his right as chairman told so-and-so to do such-and-such. So this was originally for a star 640 light years away using. This has the star using the engine, and that's crazy. Okay. And then the rest of the sentence is kind of junk. One Rocketdyne F1 engine, so much thrust, strapped to some ship, about the mass of a car, system sitting at approximately 10,000 kilogram pressure. This unit would take just under 98 days from the acceleration of that. Okay, so I rewrote that, and it was nice to be able to read it, to find a sentence that was sufficiently bad that I could actually improve it. However, in the frame of a traveler in a 10,000 kilogram spaceship propelled by a Rocketdyne F1 engine with 770 kilonewtons of thrust and an acceleration of 770 meters per second squared, this journey would take just under 98 days. This is again, incredible is a very strong word. I wouldn't have used it. All right, let's go back to the original to see if there's anything more in red here. Well, I guess I didn't put in. I changed things, but the way I didn't put in the colors, so. All right, well, let's just leave that one the way it is. Unless, if you want, we could maybe okay. So would you like? For those of you in the class here, would you like to offer suggestions for how to improve the rest of it? I don't think I've worked through it, or if I have, I didn't color code it, so I'm not sure what I changed. In fact, the journey has taken quite a long time to oversee from mission control, 640 years and 9 days. So in other words, in the rest frame of Earth, this would have been a long time. Well, okay, this is obviously wrong. I would have said sat cozily in his or her ship for 3 or so months. This last sentence here, this last phrase is awkward. Does anybody want to fix it?
Starting where?
Huh?
Is it the nations?
Well, it just seemed that neighbor was used twice, and it's just a star that is a, well, it's, I guess it's all right, it's not that bad.
Could you say relatively near to us in our own galactic neighborhood?
Yeah, that's better. Again, using is misused in the next sentence here. So the idea here is he's now it's under a tour of the center of the galaxy. Using the midpoint of distance approximations, the center of the galaxy lies. Well, the center of the galaxy is not using the midpoint of distance approximations. Yes.
So for the fractions in there, they've been spelling out the numbers, and then they're using actual numbers. I've been told not to do that. Like, because they're writing out 2/3 instead of, like, putting 2/3. Like, they're actually spelling it out plus using
you,
actual numbers.
So you
numbers.
Think one should spell it out. Is that right?
Like, they're switching between spelling it out and using actual numbers. Shouldn't they just pick either using actual numbers or spelling
okay,
it out?
Okay, I think you're right. I think you're right. That it, what our videographer is saying is that you should either write out all the numbers in English words, 3, T-H-R-E-E, and so forth, or use Arabic numbers for them, but don't mix them. Now, there is an exception to that, though. Namely, in ordinary writing, the numbers don't occur that much. And so you typically write out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But starting with 10, you can use Arabic numbers. Now, in more technical writing, you certainly would use 640, unless you're writing a bank check in which you write out 640 and then write the thing in Arabic numbers. Where did the writer go back to writing out ordinary numbers?
Nations
everything
have been
seems to be numerical Arabic here.
2/3 of millennium, like
where?
The nations have been born and fallen, and then it says 2/3. And my question was
here. Why don't you use the pointer?
Okay. So, oh, right there.
Oh. Yeah.
Yeah, 2/3.
Well, in any case, 2/3 has to be hyphenated.
Yeah.
And 2/3 of a millennium is a kind of crunchy, awkward phrase in any case. I mean, in as much as more than half a millennium would have been easy. Alright, anyway, there are a lot of ways to change these things. But in any event, using has to be changed here. Where was this? Yeah. So what you could say, in fact, I would leave out the using altogether. The center of the galaxy lies about 26,000 light years from Earth is good enough. You don't need to have the whole phrase starting with using could be dropped. So this sentence here could have been collapsed somewhat. In the same spaceship, the journey would take only 131 days for our explorer. Little puzzles to why. Oh, 131 days. Back on Earth, 26,000 years would have passed. Apparently, that's one way, and round trip is this much. And well.
Excellent, professor. Is it fine to write exclamation sign after explorer?
Here, why don't I give you the pointer in your hand?
Is it fine to give this exclamation sign here?
Yeah, I would say be careful using exclamation points. I certainly wouldn't have used it there. I mean, mean, it's not, you know, illegal, but it's, but exclamation points are to be used sparingly. By the way, let me just mention something about green lasers. The way a green laser works is it has a crystal or some medium that converts two infrared photons into one green photon. The conversion process is very inefficient, so the infrared photon beam has to be very intense. Now, the thing is supposed to be designed in such a way that the infrared beam doesn't get out. But if it does get out, it can damage one's eye. And the other unfortunate aspect of it that's really dangerous is your eyes don't see the infrared, so you don't realize you're getting blinded. So it's dangerous to use. I typically like to use red. And if you are using a green pointer, make sure you don't point it at anybody. So let's see, you were saying something.
Yeah. So when reporting error, so if it says 52,000 years and a day, do you report error in text or do you put it as a footnote? Or how should you do it?
Oh, I would not say and a day. I mean, after all, if you say about 50,000 years, you certainly don't need to say and a day.
Yeah, I mean,
that's just stupid.
Yeah. I was just curious for other things. So, for example, if it was like, 1.2, microcoulombs or something, plus or minus, would you put the error as a footnote or would you put it in text? What would you suggest?
All right, let me tell you something that Roy Glauber said to me many years ago. He said, avoid footnotes entirely.
Oh, come on.
because they distract the reader, and obviously they break the reader's attention. I would say that, first of all, if you say 11,000, what you mean, this is the same thing as what is it, plus or minus 100? In other words, because of all these zeros, you're implicitly saying that you're leaving out these digits either because you don't know them or because you don't care. But in any case, you don't mean that it's 11,000 as opposed to 11,012. Okay. So, on the other hand, if you're reporting a scientific measurement, then you might say 1.23 plus or minus 0.002. You might say that. And there's nothing wrong with having that in the text, in the paragraph, in the sentence.
Okay.
Better than having a footnote.
Okay.
Okay, so where were we here? I think it was, we were talking about another using that was long. I think we finished with this, although it was useful in that it... Okay, now here, let me get back to the raw, where's the raw text, okay. So here is something that I had to speak with a... job candidate this afternoon, and I didn't get time to fix this. One of the things people sent me was, what makes a croissant so delectable? So let's read through this, why don't we collectively go through this and see who can spot a mistake and suggest an improvement, although it may be perfect, I don't know. What makes croissant so, not surprisingly, croissant owes its wonderful flakiness to the fat, which makes it specifically the fat stress and strain characteristics along with it. So, all right, well, obviously that sentence needs work because I couldn't read it. So, owes its wonderful flakiness to the fat.
I think you can get rid of along with it and just say and overall structure. Like, I think you can say specifically the fat stress and strain characteristics and overall structure.
Yeah, I think that's better. In other words, one is linked to the fat, comma, specifically the fat's stress and strain characteristics along with its overall structure. Is that what you were saying?
I was saying take out the comma along with it.
Well, for sure, take out the comma, yeah.
But also removing the along with it and replacing that with the and. Stress and strain characteristics and its overall structure.
Yeah, that's better. Absolutely. Okay. So in other words, what we've changed this to the fat, specifically, well, we need a comma or something. A dash or a comma to the fat, so let us say, comma, specifically the fat stress and strain characteristic and its overall structure. All right, that's a first approximation. So these guys studied exactly this. They began by analyzing the stress and strain of croissants made with two different kinds of fat, roll-in and all-purpose. Well, normally one needs hyphens when compound adjectives that stand before the noun they modify, but when the noun isn't there, you don't need the hyphen. So I would have said, drop those hyphens. I would say, drop those hyphens. With a method that measured the material's response to oscillations called large amplitude oscillatory shear, they plotted the stress by strain, or maybe stress against the strain. I would say this would be a better sentence if you started out with, they used a method that measures the material's response to oscillations called large amplitude, or maybe what they should say, maybe what they they used a method called large amplitude oscillatory shear to measure the material response to oscillations and plotted the stress against the strain, or something like that. Large amplitude oscillations, we do need a hyphen here. Okay, the strain is presumably measured as a percentage of the croissant's final length by the original length. Well, we need a change here because it's the whole point is that it's a change in the length, while the stress is the applied pressure to the croissant. So the strain is the fraction, I would say, instead of percentage, the strain is the fractional change in the length of the croissant, and the stress is the applied pressure to the croissant. And this probably should have come before using stress and strain in that sentence. So you should define a term before using it, rather than use the term and then define it. In these plots, or in their plots, I would have said, the all-purpose fat croissant exhibited a sharp peak in stress at low strain, I would have said. Now, you see suggesting here being either a present participle or a gerund, whatever it is. Anyway, suggesting has to modify something, and here it's the only subject available is croissant, so it's saying that the croissant suggested a collapse. So what you could say is which suggests a collapse of the internal structure. And then I think maybe you need a period here in a new sentence. On the other hand, the rolling fat had a subtle peak and an overall flat curve with no collapse. I'm not sure what the collapse is. Therefore, while rolling fats do not excel in effects on cardiovascular health, they at least demonstrate better textures for the croissant. Well, this is kind of silly, I guess, maybe at the very least. While rolling fats, actually, it would be better to say what the rolling fats are. Presumably, if they're bad for the heart, they're either trans fats or they're saturated fats or they have lots of cholesterol. So a better way of saying it would be, although rolling fats are bad for the heart, are bad for the circulatory system because whatever the reason is, I don't actually know, they do give better croissants. Images of the croissant structure were made through electron and X-ray scattering. Rolling croissants had three main substructures. In the first nanoscale, well, I would say at nanoscales, because here it's nanoscale is an adjective and there's no noun for it to modify. The rolling fats showed small platelets of the fatty triglyceride molecules and smooth platelet boundaries. In the second, larger scale, so these are images, so I guess you could have said here, in the first nanoscale image, the rolling fats, in the second, larger scale image, and larger scale probably would be hyphenated, if the image follows it, these platelets, I don't know what the platelets are, but created stout cylindrical crystal groups, which then created, adhered to each other to create the clusters. So, obviously, the created can be used once, not twice. Presumably, the person who wrote this quickly forgot that he or she had used created twice. So, which adhere to each other, creating clusters, the clusters apparent in the third image, third largest scale image. The all-purpose fats had a similar first nanoscale, were similar at the nanoscales, although their platelets were larger and had more rigid boundaries. Additionally, the all-purpose fats did not exhibit any complex structure beyond the first scale. Thus, these second and third structures present in rolling fats could be the supporting factor in the stress strain part. Well, I don't know. So, Rodriguez and Marignoni continue to analyze the fat structures of croissants and hope of finding alternative fats for the characteristic texture while avoiding the health risks. So that sentence could be shorted a little bit in the hope of finding, or better yet, they continue to analyze the the structures of fats in croissants and hope to find alternative fats that provide an ideal texture while avoiding health risks, something like that. Anyway, I wish them luck. So let's see, where are we? What about questions? Anybody have a question?
Isn't the University of Guelph supposed to be University of Waterloo?
Say it again?
Isn't the University of Guelph supposed to be University of Waterloo, or is it a different university that is in the same town?
I don't know. If you're really curious, there's one of our graduate students is from Canada. She has an office down the hall there.
Because like when I was applying to it, it said University of Guelph and Dashi Waterloo. That's what I remember it said.
Oh, I'm sorry. There's another one that I actually did have time to work on and did work on. So let's do this one on Buddhist architecture. Unfortunately, it was too well written for me to find a lot of mistakes in it. So let's just see a few of them. Unlike Hinduism and Buddhism, there seems to be no cave complexes dedicated entirely to Jainism. I don't know what Jainism is. But you see, there seems is wrong. There is an adverb. The subject is cave complexes, which is plural, so it has to be there seems. So here's the corrected version is...
New. I think you just want that.
Okay, so I change it to their seam. Let's see if there's anything. It seems to be the only one that I color-coded as an error. What could be fixed is some of the language. I don't think one needs often times. One could just say often without the times. Are often incorporated into the architectures, paintings, and reliefs. Now,
in terms of the structure.
Say it again.
In terms of the structure.
What structure? Of the fats and the croissant?
Of the sentences.
Oh.
I thought that the junior logic, there's this intentional logic, which is 356, right? And then there's linear logic. Connectives.
I don't really see the.
From a top-down perspective, on the you look at the structure of sentences, breaking it down. I guess for linguistics they use linear logic.
Well, I've never studied linguistics, and the last time I had a course in logic, I was your age. So that's a long time ago.
So I guess this is kind of like a subset of that, right?
I don't know. It seems to me there's a very long distance between logic and computer science and group writing. Those are two.
Yeah, but they use linear logic for both of those.
Yeah. Well, I don't even know what linear logic is. Let me just try to fix this a little bit. So we could say images of the Buddha are often incorporated into the architecture in paintings and reliefs. And then which differentiates it from... So the question here is, what does which refer to? If it refers to images, then differentiate should be plural. It should be differentiate. If which refers to the whole process, then differentiate could be singular. The problem with the sentence is that it's not obvious what which refers to. And so having something unclear is not good. The Hindu caves...
I think which refers to the architecture. Yeah, I think...
Which refers to
the architecture, through paintings and reliefs. That's the process which differentiates it from Hindu caves, I guess. That which defines the architecture.
Are oftentimes incorporated into the architecture.
Through paintings and reliefs.
I don't think so.
Really?
Well, look, it's sufficiently unclear that it needs to be clarified by restructuring the sentence. And since I don't know what they're talking about, I can't do it. Let's just go to the next sentence. The Hindu caves exempted the Buddha for more deity-oriented representations of Shiva and Ganesh. Exempted is kind of weird here, I would think. A better sentence might be that in Hindu caves, one finds... Shiva and Ganesh representing deities more often than Buddha.
Could you just...
Buddha wasn't a deity, right? Buddha was a human, right? Mm-hmm.
Could you just replace exempted with replaced? The Hindu caves replaced the Buddha for more deity-oriented representations, such as Shiva and Ganesh.
So let's see. Say that again.
The Hindu caves replaced the Buddha for more deity-oriented representations, such as Shiva and Ganesh. You just switch.
Well,
it
but you can't have a cave doing anything. A cave is just a hole in the ground, right? Or a hole in the ground.
Yeah, but representations is
the
main
subject. It's kind of some kind of representation.
Yeah, it's the main subject of it, and representations, I'm assuming, can be anywhere. It just makes more sense to replace one word.
This, anyway, exempted is bad, and that sentence needs work. I'm not quite sure how to fix it. Let's go down to the next one. Unlike Hinduism and Buddhism, there seem to be no cave complexes dedicated to entirely to Jainism. Instead, Hindu and Buddhist caves tend to have Jainist elements such as the Ahimsa. To have sacred places carved into mountains is a testament to the mathematical prowess of the ancient Indians who constructed these caves, I would say, rather than that. So much so that the methods the architects used to carve into the face of the cliff of the cliffside still baffles historians today. I guess that's possible. Anyway, the intensity also speaks to the importance of the earth in the religions of India. Well, if they mean planet Earth, it should be capitalized. On the other hand, they may mean Earth in the sense of ground, and so I'm not sure what. So, in other words, if it's the Earth, it should be capitalized. Otherwise, it could be the importance of Earth in the religions of India. And I'm not sure which, since I'm not familiar with this subject. These caves and their elements became a house for the supernatural as their careful attention to the way light plays with the inside highlights the importance of certain subjects. All right, well, this sentence certainly needs work. So here, there refers to caves. The caves don't have attention, right? So, I mean, it's a miserable sentence. The warm tones of the paintings, coupled with the round figure which it portrays, accentuates the importance of lighting and the shape of the spaces. Well, at the very least, one could say the warm tones of the painting, coupled with the round figure of Buddha, rather than which it portrays. And inasmuch as it's warm tones, that's plural, so it should be accentuating the importance of lighting and the shape of the spaces. And I suppose the reason why the singular verb was used is because there's an it, which is singular, that occurs there. People often make that mistake in speech, less often in writing, but it's that what determines this, whether the verb is singular or plural is whether the subject of the verb is singular or plural, not whether the nearest noun is singular or plural. So we're just about out of time. Let's just see what else we've got here. Although Buddhist architecture slowly lost its individuality as it adopted more Hindu doctrines, the survival of Ajanta speaks to the importance that Buddhism still has in Indian culture, separate of Hinduism. So that's a fair phrase, that separate of Hinduism. So let's just see. Although Buddhist architecture slowly lost as it adopted more Hindu doctrines, no, doctrine is the word, but anyway, the survival of Ajanta, I would say, suggests that Buddhism remained important in Hindu, Indian culture. Something
or we can add like instead of separate of, we can say like different from Hinduism. Instead of separate of, we can replace it by different from Hinduism.
Yeah, I guess so. By the way, that reminds me of another, you may be right, but that reminds me of another odd and end. The word different from, you say John, or salt is different from sugar. The British often say salt is different to sugar. Why they would say that, I don't know. But in general, a common mistake is salt is different than sugar. It's salt is saltier than sugar, and that makes it different from sugar. That's the way I would say it. Okay, so why don't we stop if there's no further